on to our next discussion, which is on the local bodies. And again, as I said, Mr. Nirmal Bansal, who was to be moderating this panel, has had an emergency in the family on account of COVID. He is not in a position to join us. I've requested Mr. G.B. Panda to step in for him. And the summing up would be done by our senior fellow, Mr. U.K. Sharma. Let me, before I hand over to Mr. G.B. Panda, introduce him. He is an MPhil in Sociology and Anthropology, is a former Syrian Advisor Planning Commission, and is a senior fellow Scotch Development Foundation. You've heard him speak. He has worked in various capacities involving research and fieldwork, planning, policy formulation and evaluation, plan allocations and monitoring. His areas of work included gender, children, PWDs, drug and substance abuse across various ethnic communities, tribes and culturally diverse groups. He was also a special rapporteur, National Human Rights Commission. And with this, I invite Mr. G.B. Panda to take further the proceedings.
Welcome to the second session, wherein we will be, you know, taking, you know, into account the local bodies in terms of governance, as to how much they have done and what initiative they have taken as regards to the specific areas they have, you know, reflected in their projects. So, there are five, six of them: GIS mapping of Nandumangad municipality. There is one Kolkata Greenhouse Society at Tata Cancer Hospital. Then Sangli Miraj managing disaster management. Then Jilla Parishad in terms of pension digitization. And there is a district which is 5,000 schools that have been upgraded in Jilla Parishad Jalgaon. So there are others also. So these are some of the specific areas that the local bodies have taken special initiative as they found the areas that are critical to them and need to be attended to. So
a couple of things to be added there. When we say that these are the perspective remains the same, which is the connected government. So we have had
right.
A from that perspective on the districts. Now we are the other leg of the government is local bodies. So essentially, our imperatives remain the same. But here we talk more in the context of the 73rd and 74th constitutional amendment, wherein
local
bodies have become the interaction layer for the citizens. And it will mean transacting online and for government availability of error-free data and better targeting of delivery of services. So just bring in that perspective as well. So yes, as you rightly said, let's have one by one, and then we will get into a discussion.
No, especially you rightly point out, the 74th Amendment has given enough room for effective governance across the sectors to see that the best possible services and support are given to their citizens in the respective local bodies. And it is also directed to see that there are some protective measures as well taken to let not happen any other untoward incidents, or if something happened in terms of disasters like COVID and otherwise, how they will handle and put their responsibility and accountability in place. So these are some of the areas, and other aspect that which is important is this, is giving a, you know, honorable civic life in terms of comfort, in terms of availability of services, in terms of security, in terms of all the civic amenities. So these are some of the areas that the Constitution 74th Amendment provides the local bodies enough powers and responsibilities. So keeping that in perspective, each of these districts have local bodies have their own specific areas that they presented. So in this context, we can invite one by one the municipalities to make their specific special presentation as regard the subject and the project they have in hand. So may I invite Nandimangad Municipality Corporation on GIS mapping?
Hello, yes. Can you hear me?
Please go ahead. Yes.
Yeah. We have a geo information project for the municipality, and this is a GIS mapped, GIS based web information software. The objects in each cadastral map of the municipality is mapped by geo referencing using longitude and latitude value of the plot. This is a comprehensive geo-based web application which records individual buildings details according to their numbers allotted by the municipality. The software is designed to store, analyze, and make available all the required details of as and when it required. This software will enable the municipality have a better understanding of its resources, and it have a plan. It is used for making planning, management, and coordinate coordinate various projects with the help of the GIS based system. It is advisable to all local bodies to have maps giving details of all the roads coming under its jurisdiction. Road connecting maps in the process of referencing all the roads, including national highways, major district roads, village roads, foot lanes, etc., into the cadastral map. Since road map cannot fully cover the status of the roads and proposed works to be carried out, a report is also getting from this software. This is helpful to the municipality for construct and maintain the roads which are under this region. This also helps the authorities to ensure accuracy and clarity in traffic planning. This software contains detailed reports of wards, boundaries, land use, street light, water sources, open well, and the buildings, and it also records the inhabitants of each building, and we are also collecting details about various welfare pensions beneficiaries, and it helps us to make our project more useful to the downtrodden. Thank you, sir. Hello.
Hello. Thank you. You have really integrated the various departments into a system of digitization through GIS mapping. So you have all the departments, and you have land, you have agriculture, you have roads, and many other departments. So you have also done the coordination job between the departments very effectively. So could you reflect upon, and you have a good team also, teamwork. And so could you reflect upon as to what are the challenges that you face, or rather the in GIS based mapping, and also what has actually necessitated that GIS mapping is required, and how far this identification of requirement has been met by the municipality in its own assessment?
So we have arranged various meetings of the various stakeholders, and we coordinate various departments, and we ask the primary difficulty is to attach the cadastral map into GIS platform. So we have about 20,000 odd buildings in our municipality, and we have to go to each and every one to collect the inhabitants of each building. So we have made a very wide range of stakeholder meetings.
Now, do the information that you have collected through GIS mapping, is it available to anybody who wants to make use of it?
No. It is a source. It is not open to all. We have made some details into public.
If it's not a shared data, it is in-house data, then how do you get into consultation with the local bodies, the municipal and other the municipality members vis-a-vis the people who matter in this area?
So we have consulted them, and with the help of them, we collected that is details of the inhabitants, also that nature of the building, so on.
See, the one aspect that you have mentioned that you have collected information on individuals.
Yeah.
Right? Okay.
Yeah.
Now, and what kind of data you collect on individuals? And I remember the some data that you, information that get on individuals, like in census data, it is a classified data. You cannot share with that. But in what purpose that you take this information and individuals, and how this is used, for what purpose?
So it is mainly we collect details of the pensioners. We are giving welfare pension to ground town people. So we have details of them, and we are not sharing to anyone. It is for municipality.
Is this for only the pensioners, not for all?
No, not all.
So then you have also said that you use this data for planning, development planning in the municipality. Okay. Could you say that how much of this improvement brought about in the governance and especially in the planning and implementation of the planning in translation of the things which are your plan is converted into the implementation.
So we have collected the details of electric posts and natural light associated with them, and we have now collected details of the tube light or ordinary bulbs, and we are making them. We are using that data to shift that into all bulbs into LED bulbs. And we are also collecting details of the roads, which are the roads are mud, and we are using that details to make them tarred or concrete roads.
So suppose if I need to know about the information of how you have the culverts and drainage of the municipality and how it is managed, and as to how you collect the municipality waste and the quantum of the waste you collect, and how do you manage this waste management, and what you do with the pollution control, etc. How do you reflect in this project of yours, mapping?
So we have three decentralized places where waste are taken from the households, and we have managed to make it by methanization and convert into manure, and we are also collecting plastic waste from the door to door and using them for tarring after shredding.
Okay, now you have also certain obligations as to clear disputes also, you mentioned, through investigation. So what are these investigations and disputes that you resolve? What are the areas?
So, yes, in the slum, we have 9 slums in the municipality, and we make use of these resources, and we are identifying most needy roads which are to be tarred or concreted, and we are doing that roads preferences
No, the information that you collect with, through the GS mapping, do you share with the state, centralized state statistics or department with concerns in this area?
So we are using that. That we have not shared it.
If the state government, the state authorities, the state government would like to know what's happening through GIS map of your municipality, how they make a connection with you?
Sorry, sir. We have not shared the details to them, but we are giving reports based on these projects to state government.
Well, no, fine. I mean, this one of the our objective is the connectivity. So this is what we are trying to understand, how do the municipality GIS mapping and their activities stay connected to overall state administration and governance. So this is, that's what we interested to know, that that's what the question was posed to you. The idea is, see, the GIS mapping.
Hello?
See, I said that the GIS mapping is not begins and ends with the your municipality alone. It's a domain area, but in the larger context of the administration and governance, it has to be a part of the total system of sharing in the state level. So how do you go about it?
So we will approach the state government to fall on no, connectivity to other local bodies, because in Kerala, this is one of my municipality, is one of the municipality which up to date into which done the projects like this. So when other local body are making use of GIS mapping, we are happy to share the message, this platform, to them also.
But there is no portal as to where the data is, the GIS data is shared with the state level. Automatically. Okay. Any other questions, sir? From
we can move on to the next one.
Okay. Now we can move on to Kolkata Green Society. This is Tata Cancer Hospital parking situation resolution.
Good morning, sir. This is Animesh Bhattacharj. I am the CEO of Kolkata Green Smart City Corporation, and I like to discuss our project which is under consideration of SCOTCH, and the name of the project is Smart Parking Solution at Tata Medical Center, near Tata Medical Center. So actually, we faced a typical situation, and all of we know that it is a very difficult to get a parking slot in cosmos cities like Calcutta or other cities like Bangalore or Bombay or Delhi. And as soon as some agencies engaged by the corporation or the local bodies, some malpractice cripples in the system, where the agency charges two times, three times, even sometimes four times for the parking. And a person who is coming to the Tata Center, and this is the cancer hub of Eastern Zone, it is Tata Cancer Medical Hospital, this is the cancer hub of Eastern Zone, lot of people are coming with cars, and they like to have a pre-booking for parking of their car. And for this reason, we introduced this thing. This is a app-based system where the parking slots are divided into separate zones, and in each zone there is some sensor, and that senses the existence and appearance of the car, And in this way, a person is able to see from his house if there is any vacancy in the slot. And he can also pre-book the slot. Even when he is starting from the home, he can assess that after 1 or 2 hours, he will be reaching the Tata Center and he can book the slot accordingly. And he can drive into the slots and the entry is recorded by camera and it is stored in cloud. And maybe after 1 or 2 hours, he can leave the slot and it is not necessary to interact with anybody. His exit is also recorded by the camera and it is stored in the cloud and some message is received by that person and he is able to pay online. So, this was the necessity also because we know that during this pandemic situation, we should avoid physical interaction. By this process, there is no physical interaction and there is no human intervention. And I would like to also mention that presently, we are also trying to make it compatible with FASTag. As soon as we can make it compatible with FASTag, then all the vehicles having the FASTag, they do not need to download this special app in their mobile. They can use the FASTag app and can access the parking slots. This is the basic things of the whole matter. And this is now used as a pilot case. And for last 1 year, we are using this thing. And it is successful model. And we have the planning to replicate this thing in all other parking areas. This is the main thing, sir.
Thank you. Anything else? Anything else you want to say on this?
Since this is the pandemic situation, so I would like to mention that last year we also launched another thing which is called neighborhood networking. Because last year, as you know, during the pandemic situation and also this year, the present condition is that there are so many citizens and mainly the senior citizens who are residing in their home and they feel isolated because the households, I mean the domestic helps are not coming because of this pandemic situation. They are not in a position to go out for ration, for shopping or for getting the medicines supply. And during this situation, the smart city took the initiative to contact them over telephone. And after getting the phone from the smart city people, smart city employee, the citizen feels the confidence that yes, there is somebody to take care of them. And we have also engaged some volunteers who are ready to dedicate their service with their own vehicle, maybe 4-wheeler, maybe 2-wheeler, even maybe the cycles. And they are taking the medicine from the medicine shops and they are supplying it to the houses. So this is another initiative taken by the smart city. That's all, sir.
Thank you. But you have really, really taken, sensitive to the two critical areas. And one being the parking, which is a universal problem across all the metropolities and towns as well. Considering the increase in the numbers and the lack of space provides this lag as to how to manage, parking. So especially you have utilized the app-based system in, making it easy and also viable and also accommodatable, parking and not coming to the place and crowding over there, but from the home they can operate upon. This is a remarkable thing. Now, since that you have initiated at a particular place at the Tata Center, Cancer Center, now because it has all the provisions of CC camera, what have you, that provides the connectivity and the people can visualize the situation and see this lot of vacancy there. But there must be some many other areas and localities and public places where parking is chaotic. So how do you think, now it is a pioneer work we have done. So you have to, if we want to replicate this in other areas, what are you trying to do? What are your plans are like?
We have already taken the plans and schemes are on and tender process is on. And we think that we can replicate this in a big scale in other areas, other parking areas, near other malls. There are some malls are there and there are some markets are there. And near markets and malls, we can introduce this thing again. And we have taken all this planning and we hope that within 6 months or 1 year, we can replicate these things in other places.
No, the malls have their own way of dealing things and your supplementation through your app will also help. But the you are tendering out, are you getting into PPP mode?
Not, it is not like PPP mode. Uh-huh. It is actually we have our own parking slots, parking spaces, many. Almost all the parking spaces are owned by the local authority of NKDA. And we just invite the agency through tender to implement this thing. And all other things is managed by our staff, sir.
Anyway, since this is a pilot project which you started very well, now since you are expanding to other areas as well, now, have you made a survey of the parking place as to how much space is available, how much cars can be parked, and what would be the pragmatic approach to strategize your app-based system?
It is 80% covered because the conventional system of parking is already there. And we know our capacity of parking, how many cars can be parked there. We know all these things, but there are some fringe areas, especially there is some parking without permission, which take place along the busy roads near markets. That is our problem. We are now thinking how to solve this problem, but the measure and the number of cars to be parked in the well-defined parking spaces, all these things are known to us, sir.
Although this app-based system which is started with the cancer hospital is a very pioneering effort, but as you said that there are challenges in the parking. So are you planning to have some kind of multi-layered planning in terms of different story planning where you can also
matching
with the number of vehicles in the parking?
Yes, sir. There is nearly a big project has been taken. A big project has been taken for valet parking up to several tiers. And as per assessment, that can hold nearly 500 to 700 cars at a time, sir. And the scheme is on. We have already prepared the scheme. It is already vetted. And part funding will be from a smart city and part funding will be from our local bodies and other development authorities, sir.
There are two aspects we would like to get educated about is that besides this parking at cancer hospital, that other plans that you have in other areas to do this similar kind of a thing, what kind of challenges you foresee are you facing? Number two is that, see, in what way you are resolving these challenges you've identified. Number three is that, see, are you also coordinating with other such cities and municipalities across West Bengal as a policy across the state to replicate or adapt a similar approach?
Yes, sir. Actually, there is a project which is called the Smart Street. There is a Smart Street here where all the components like smart parking, like smart bench, like smart solar trees, like smart charging for electric vehicles, all these components are demonstrated there. And it is designed in such a way that when we do invite other municipalities, they can oversee all the components in the same road, in the same span of maybe of 2 kilometers. So this is the way we are planning, and the project is completed now. And this is the way we are showcasing our schemes, our products to others.
Would the if you have to have such a parking elsewhere in the Kolkata, smart city, what will be the fund requirement, and have you made any provision in your budget for the same?
Yes, it is budgeted, because I have just mentioned that big project of multi-layers parking is partly funding by Smart City and would be partly funded by that HITCO, which is the another development authority, and partly by NKDA, which is the local bodies. And if we can construct this thing after completion of the project, I think that parking problem for coming 10 to 20 years will be solved, sir.
See, now since you have started very well and also planning to have it across the smart city, now how much time it will take to accomplish the projects that you are visualizing for future?
That will take some time, sir. I think it will take minimum 2 years from now, since now. Minimum 18 months since now.
Now, since you said that, you see, there is already amount is budgeted, right?
Budgeted,
then,
sir.
Budgeted. Then what is the budget? Have you given any target for accomplishing, to the what extent or full extent as per the budget provision, the project?
That is not decided yet. We have the plan in our mind that we shall go for construction of the whole project, of the whole building, and we can manage the budget also, sir. So this is the situation. If we start, we shall go for the whole project.
No, they put in other words, the budgeted amount that you had last year, last financial year, how much it could be achieved, and what was the how much has been the expenditure, and what has been the physical outcome against this expenditure?
It is now presently the vetting process is on, and as soon as it will be vetted, we shall go for tender. It will take some time. And as soon as it is started, from the day of starting, I think it will take 18 months of time. And after 18 months or after 20 months, we'll be able to use it actually, and we'll be able to make it operational.
No, my question was,
yeah,
if some amount was budgeted in the last financial year, if it remain unutilized, is it, has it lapsed, or you are forwarded to the this year, this financial year, current financial?
No. Yeah, it is not lapsed. There is no scope being lapsed because all the fund is kept in our account, in the account of HIDCO and account of Smart City. So there is no scope to lapse the funds.
In other words, you see, parking of funds without utilization also worrisome factor, right? So now, since you are calling in the process of calling a tender, so now that funds that you are having in hand as budgeted last financial year, this financial year, would you be able to utilize in accomplishing the task?
In 21-22, in 21, this is April of this financial year. So within this financial year, the component of Smart City will be used. I think the component of Smart City will be utilized, and the other part, that is the financial part, the financial contribution of other development authority would be partly used.
So now we are going to Jalgaon municipality as regards improvised Jilla Parishad as regards 5,000 schools infrastructure development.
Good afternoon, sir. Distinguished panelists, experts, moderator, senior fellow panelists, and participants. Thanks for giving me this opportunity. We know we have attempted here to connect between gram panchayats, district administration, district development planning committee, and state government. This was the attempt made. Basically, we know that local bodies, especially panchayat raj institutions, are empowered to develop as per their local specific needs and empowered financially and administratively with technical tools at root level. However, capacity building and sensitization, particularly orientation towards prioritizing development works, is required. Sir, say, utilize funds of various schemes and departments through convergence mode should be the priority area for holistic and balanced sustainable development of local bodies. So appropriate use of available softwares and electronic technology will ease the mounting pressure on governance and will also help in providing in-time services. So we have made attempt to provide a secure environment in the schools through convergence of MG Narega, 14th and 15th finance scheme, and district development funds through state government. So in the first, this thing, out of 1,800 schools, we are attempting 925 school compound walls. And further, with a compound wall, plantation of around 124,526 we have completed. And vegetable paras bags have been developed through public participation. Color and slogan paintings have also been done by volunteers from village teachers and students. Trees have been adopted by parents and teachers. And during lockdown period, because this work has been completed within a span of 45 days during first lockdown, where migration of large-scale labors were done, and government has instructed us to provide labor to the migratory workers who have come to the district at various places. So this was one of the good opportunity we found to provide labor to them, and we have created 5 lakh plus man days through this work. And there is participation of village sarpanch, entire village, block education officer, public works department, your finance department, and entire Jilla Parishad to motivate this work. So by this way, we could create a secure environment which could provide not only this thing, employment to more than 10,000 manual laborers, but also provided protection to the school infrastructure, also provided enhanced toilet uses, which were created through SBM and other social justice departments fund, and especially by girl childs. So this was also a good thing. Then enrollment in the schools also increased, dropout decreased, protection from encroachment also was the added advantage. Then restriction on antisocial elements, tree plantation, more than 1 lakh tree was planted. Education wall paintings, protection from wild and domestic animals. This has increased the use of playground in the school campus. And most important is ambience was developed for the entire school, which was the central government's motto. Even Prime Minister had addressed in the last this thing that ambience in the school is very important. So when first lockdown was about to close and schools were open for some time, students were very surprised to see their schools. So this was the benefit. And this model was again appreciated by our finance minister, and they had sent special team to inspect how this model has been implemented at the district level. And now this model has been adopted by the state government through a special resolution in the MGNREGA. So this model is, I think, replicable over all over the state, and it will be useful because of around only 40 to 45% schools in the state have protection wall as on today. So through this model, we will be able to develop 60% compound walls in the entire state if implemented properly and again in an improved way. Thank you very much.
Mr. Panda, you're on mute.
Thank you very much. You have touched upon an area of great concern, especially the institution of learning, the schools. As you rightly said, the schools need to have certain ambience and certain atmosphere, certain space, certain infrastructure to work as a place of learning. And especially because the children of 6 to 14 are there, they need a specific environment, playground, other infrastructure that conduces you to learning and growing. Now, you have started with the 500 schools, and you got the support from 14th Finance Commission, from you get also asset support from Gram Panchayat, and also you roped in MGNREGA and quite a bit. I mean, that's a great initiative in making connectivity. This is a required thing. And the other thing that is a factor which is now as a constant comes to us. See, now we are in a critical phase of pandemic where the schools are not functioning. So we don't know as to how long this will continue as of now. And we have invested quite a bit in infrastructure and walls and toilets and classrooms and plantation, etc. In the process of schools not working, then how are we going to manage on a regular basis? What is the HR there to look after this? And also, how do we manage in terms of that sustenance of this effort that you made? Now you have, I think, against the target of 500, you have already done around 538 schools you have achieved doing plantation and etc. The worrisome factor, as I repeat to myself, that how do we sustain these efforts and infrastructure when the schools are not functioning?
Sir, in the second pandemic also, students are not allowed to attend the schools, but teachers are there in the schools, and teachers are helping basically to sensitize the villagers about COVID appropriate movement. So we have mandated teachers to be present in the school, and they are doing good job. We have constituted village committees also, COVID village committee. The teachers are part of this committee to sensitize the villagers, and also if needed, some people we are presumptive cases of the corona. We are allocated school rooms to isolate and quarantine in the schools at the initial stage till the time they are taken to the CCC center, COVID care hospitals. So by that way, teachers are there and schools are properly, this infrastructure is properly protected.
No, see, we have certain parameters, certain requirements, recognized requirements of a school, both in terms of infrastructure and other things. And we have a list of those things across the schools. That how much, if we have to, somebody want to understand, this is the list of requirements of a school to be a normal school place of learning, then how much of that has been, you know, we have addressed to, how much of that has been accomplished. So that is one question. The second question comes, you know, it's one good thing that you've done, that once you have made the compound wall and the area becomes a restricted area in a way to not letting it happen, any untoward incident or encroachment or anti-social elements. Okay. Now, since the schools are not functioning, the teachers go in the daytime only, but other things need to be protected. There's all this infrastructure we invested into. Unless the school is in full swing of functioning, there is somebody to look after on a regular basis. How do we manage this, all this infrastructure and all that things that you intend to prevent, for which purpose you projectize this thing?
Sir, I got two questions. First one is parameters for the schools. So first one is that through CSR, because during the first pandemic, digital education, online education was the requirement of the state. So through CSR, out of 1800 schools, 1500 schools we could develop as a digital schools, and so through CSR activity we could install their digital screens, computers, and softwares for internet and router and etc. And teachers used to start their Google Meet or Zoom meetings from the classrooms. So that is the that was the one thing. Apart from other infrastructures and school ground and playground, other sports facilities and toilets and all things, all the parameters which are generally required in the school are developed. Second part of question was of protection and sustainability of this infrastructure developed in the school. So as I said, teachers are present in the school apart from few vacations, 15 days or 16 days. Second, this most of the infrastructure like plantation or vegetable gardens are adapted by the villagers and some parents. So they are always there to watering them, or they are attached with that and they are protecting them. And they are also getting benefit. So they are harvesting good tomatoes or vegetables. So they are always, some presence is always there from the villager side. And they have since their participation is also there since development, they have feel their participation is important and they have feel their role in the school. So they are protecting it. And that's the sustainable way. Unless that attachment is there, not there, then it is very difficult to protect the school compound.
Now, I appreciate, really this is something very great achievement, in sense that you brought this sense of ownership among the people. So that's what it is. See, that's what the critically I want to know as to how, see, we alone can't go in such a crisis unless the people themselves take the ownership and responsibility. So you have motivated probably, and you also, you know, identified people to take care of such things. So anyway, now, are you going in a big way in the present, covering other schools as well when the pandemic is on?
Yes, sir, we have a target of 925 schools, and we are going to achieve this target by the end of this month also. So we will have 100% compound walls by the end of June.
You also indulge MG Narega workers in this, is it?
Yes, sir. Full, same model, sir. This model is being replicated. And state government has also, finance minister has also directed that other districts should follow this model for protecting their schools.
But do, are you able to mobilize in a safe way the MG Narega laborers or workers in this pandemic time?
Sir, we have scattered the area of work and COVID appropriate behavior as mandated by the state government for labors. That is compulsory being followed. So not all more than two labor at a one place.
All right. May I request you to move over to Kozhikode, please?
Okay, Kozhikode. All right. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, we can bring the Kozhikode. What is it? Yeah, we can bring about the community kitchen of Kozhikode.
Kozhikode, yes. Can you switch on your video as well, Kozhikode? Yes, we have Ms. Bini with us.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
I think you can hear me, sir.
Yes,
we can hear you and see you both.
Okay. So we are all in the midst of a great COVID surge over here in Kozhikode.
Right.
Okay, and the relevance of the community kitchen again arises in our city. Sir, yeah. As I have earlier in our presentation, I have told that this was an initiative completely by the people of our city to serve the needy people with the food. And the Kozhikode Corporation was, we were cooking with love to all our people who are in actual need of the food. And our volunteers were ready to serve this food at their doorstep, sir. And also there were initiatives to feed our migrant laborers also, and also the stray dogs. And like all the people who are in needy during that time of pandemic. And during the, what is unique in this program is the Kozhikode Corporation has not spent even a single paisa or a single pie of money for this community kitchen. And we have done it through our people's participation. And it was a great model of people's participation in the entire state of Kerala. We have instances where the other corporations have spent crores of monies, and I myself was working in another corporation, and I know that we were spending crores of rupees of money for this community kitchen. But in Kozhikode, the entire people of Kozhikode have contributed towards this kitchen, and this it was a great model for the other corporations also, sir. And also we have selected the beneficiaries. You know, when the local self-government put up an idea for setting up of a community kitchen, you know, the people from various sources, whether they have the resources or whether they don't have the resources, they will there will come a need for the food. But what we do is, with the help of our ward representatives, who are called as councillors, and also the RRT members, rapid response teams were set up in each of the wards, and from them we selected the beneficiaries, and the foods were provided to these beneficiaries who were selected by the people themselves, and they were served with food 3 times a day. And in total we have distributed about 5,06,000 packets of food during that starting period of this COVID pandemic. And this was a mission mode we have done this. And it was also a joint effort with our Kudumbasri mission. And this Kudumbasri mission has also started community hotels, that is the Janakiya hotels, where the foods were served for the people. Those who can pay can avail it in a subsidized rate. And those who cannot pay can give it to the community kitchens. And all this was done by strictly adhering to the COVID protocols. And the not even a single case of positives was reported by this serving of the foods at the doorsteps. And all the food served adhered to all the food safety standards also. And we collected great collection drives was done by the corporation, and now we have collected about 30 to 35 lakh rupees by the public, and also the publics have donated enormously to the food grains, rice 52 tons, and also the groceries and all the other things they have supplied, and also the people have given the permission to use their for example, their private auditoriums and or other halls which are owned by these private parties. All these things were used by the corporation, and also the cooks who are expertise in cooking, they were used, and they not even paid a single pie of money by the corporation. All this was done with the volunteers, and all the great users, the people who are willing to participate in this great venture, and also the employees of the corporation was also included in preparation for the cooking and all. So we can, what we have done is, I think it's a great model to the entire state of Kerala and also to the other municipalities, because especially in this type of pandemic situations, now we are facing it. The local self-governments cannot itself, they themselves cannot handle this type of situations. And we need the participations, people's participations, and greater campaign by the people's. Only by the people's participations, we can break the chain, and also we can sustain our community, our people during this pandemic times. Sir.
Thank you very much. And we have discussed it at length when your last presentation. It's a,
okay,
it's a great effort, mobilizing people and also mobilizing resources and showing a quality leadership in, you know, providing food to the people, especially those who are migratory laborers and who are old and destitute and other needy. And you have 14 odd, you know, community centers that, am I audible?
Yes, hello? You are.
Ah, okay. So this has been done. I mean, we were discussing now this time, the pandemic has assumed it in a foremost super, what do you call it? Super infection status. So how do you have some operational, do you have some operational problems in terms of people coming close in contact to food touch and all that thing? Do you face such things now? Because this situation is not as usual as it used to be in the first stage of pandemic. Do you face any challenges now?
Sir, actually, in the second stage, we have not started the community kitchen because all the essential commodity shops are open now, and the people are coming and buying the commodities from the shops. And there is no requirement from the public for starting a community kitchen as of now.
So that means you have realized that this community kitchen is no more required as it was felt need during the first phase of pandemic.
Yes, sir. But we need this because we are planning to set up domicile care centers in each ward, so that the people who have no places in their homes can come and stay. I mean, positive people can come and stay in these DCCs. So we are planning to set up.
And these centers were not there earlier?
No, there was no, because the COVID surge is higher this time, and there was no requirement for DCCs last time. But this time, I think we need to serve food to people who are in this DCCs. And for that purpose, we are accepting the contributions from the public to set up the, such types of kitchens in each ward.
So you don't have the situation of migratory laborers or jobless laborers or, you know, destitute aged persons or other destitute persons unless they are covered in the center.
That this time we have the issues of this migrant labors and all, and they are all being tested and reported as positive in a very large number, 300 to 400 of them, and all are reporting positives. And so we have to arrange. So we have to arrange the food for these peoples, and we are expecting our public to share their valuable contribution to providing food for these peoples.
So that means that you will renew the effort that you have done earlier as well.
Yes, sir.
Sure.
Yes, we will do that.
You will do. Then, but you have not started as yet.
Not started as yet.
So when will be starting this, and have you put the needed inputs such as resources, people, and everything in place now? Because you had a break in between.
Sir, our people have contributed a large sum of money and all during the last COVID period, and that is, we have it in reserve, sir. So we can use it if the requirement arises. We will use that at the first phase for arranging foods for these people. And in the second phase, we will receive contributions from our public and will start these types of kitchens and all.
So did you anticipate the upsurge of the COVID-19 the way it is now earlier?
Yes, sir. We anticipate earlier a month itself. We anticipate because the local our state government election and all were held, and there was the people were simply reluctant to adhere to the COVID protocol. So we expect a surge, sir.
Did you feel the need of having a perspective as regards the feeding? I mean, in a sustainable way.
We are now expecting it, and we are our corporation council is in a busy schedule to grab resources from our public and to get this public contributions and all. And we are planning to start these kitchens from the next week onwards. That is, but the targeted community is positive people, the COVID positive patients.
All right. I mean, since you are doing such a remarkable job, which is much needed at the time and context, so are you also thinking in terms of having some kind of a dedicated fund, a granary bank, or something of that sort, which ensure that you don't have to run to post pillar every now and then? There is assured kind of some dedicated resources, food grains, etc.
Sir, our government has issued an order last week granting us permission for expending our own fund for these types of purposes. But we can use it for setting up our infrastructure facilities in the CFLTCs and DCCs. So if the people's contributes greater towards the foods and all, but for which they can contribute, then we can deviate our funds to the infrastructural activities for setting up good CFLTCs, oxygen beds, and all such infrastructures to this COVID positive patients, sir.
No, especially with regard to food security part.
Sir, it's not clear, sir.
Is as regards to the feeding part? I mean, that's the infrastructure going into the feeding part, which is your special initiative,
right? Sir.
How have you planned specifically for this feeding part? Have you developed a dedicated fund or food grain bank or such kind of a thing?
Yes, sir. We have planned a dedicated thing towards this feeding part, because we are expecting a lockdown next week and all, so that the people may not be able to go out. So we have planned for it, and we have the resources for it.
All right. Okay. Now, how many people you think that if the lockdown comes, you need to feed?
Sir, I think last time we need to feed 6,000, 7,000 people per day, sir.
Now, if God forbid it again comes, then what is your anticipated number of people that you may have to be prepared, sir, for feeding?
Yes, sir. These peoples were selected by the ward counselor and our rapid response team from the ward level, sir. Mm-hmm. And I think their conditions are still the same, and we need to feed 6,000, 7,000, and we are expecting even more, up to 8,000 or 9,000 people, sir.
That's the projection. Anyway, you are ready with the... Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Now, Kazikode has also another presentation to be made on street lighting.
Ms. Panda, we are running out of time. So, I think we should invite Mr. Yuga Sharma at this moment for takeaways and recommendations from this panel.
Very informative projects. We have learned a lot. In fact, 3-4 things are there. Firstly, the GIS mapping involves mapping of assets of all departments. From the context of connected government, it brings connection between various departments if GIS mapping takes place. Second takeaway is that when the cancer hospital parking was discussed, in fact, if we have money, then we can use money for creation of such infrastructure, no issue. But keeping in view the large requirement of such parking space in big cities, there is a need to explore PPP funding for such commercially viable projects, because it is a revenue earning activity. So such infrastructure can definitely be funded through private participation. That is second issue. Third issue is that community participation is very, very important. It is the core of the successful programs, whether it be school infrastructure, creation of school infrastructure, and creation of kitchen. So that is also important. So public participation is very important for the success of all these programs. These are 4 or 5 takeaways in this whole exercise.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Sharma. It's been very interesting. So, Mr. Panda, would you like to conclude the discussion so that we can go into the announcement of the next round of Scotch Order of Merit semifinalists? Please unmute yourself, Mr. Panda.
Because it's the ongoing efforts. I mean, I may conclude in a way, but efforts continue. So, all these projects that we have discussed, although small, but very, very important areas, and more important and very, it shows a vision as to how the local bodies are identifying their local area issues, besides the issues that are maybe exist is a pertinent other local bodies. So this out of box thinking and initiatives, be it community feeding at the time and or also parking and all these things are a very, very pertinent problems challenging every time now and then. Now, since these local bodies have taken vote to address to that, that itself a kind of a line of departure. So that is something very important that is recognized and need to be, appreciated. And most of the projects that we have presented today had a definite outcome, which is convincing and also makes us feel that this need to be replicable wherever it is applicable. So these are some of the observations, but there are some aspects as regards the sustainability of such ongoing issues and problems. They have to be have a perspective plan on these and also adhere to the plan in terms of a plan of action. So these are some of the things which I would like to reflect on.
Thank you so much for these inputs.